The reading this morning is from Nehemiah chapter 2. And it's the whole chapter. One day, 4 months later, when Emperor Artaxerxes was dining, I took the wine to him. He had never seen me look sad before, so he asked, "Why are you looking so sad? You aren't ill, so it must be that you are unhappy." I was startled and answered, "May your majesty live forever. How can I help looking sad when the city where my ancestors are buried is in ruins and its gates have been destroyed by fire?" The emperor asked, "What is it that you want?" I prayed to the God of heaven, and then I said to the emperor, "If your majesty is pleased with me and is willing to grant my request, let me go to the land of Judah, to the city where my ancestors are buried, so that I can rebuild the city." The emperor, with the empress sitting at his side, approved my request. He asked me how long I would be gone and when I would return, and I told him. Then I asked him to grant me the favor of giving me letters to the governors of West Euphrates province, instructing them to let me travel to Judah. I asked also for a letter to Asaph, keeper of the royal forest, instructing him to supply me with timber for the gates of the fort that guards the temple, for the city walls, and for the house I was to live in. The emperor gave me all I asked for, because God was with me. The emperor sent some army officers and a troop of horsemen with me, and I made the journey to West Euphrates. There I gave the emperor's letters to the governors, but Sanballat from the town of Beth-Horon and Tobiah, an official in the province of Ammon, heard that someone had come to work for the good of the people of Israel, and they were highly indignant. I went on to Jerusalem, and for 3 days I did not tell anyone what God had inspired me to do for Jerusalem. Then in the middle of the night I got up and went out, taking a few of my companions with me. The only animal we took was the donkey that I rode on. It was still night as I left the city through the valley gate on the west and went south past Dragon's Fountain to the rubbish gate. As I went, I inspected the broken walls of the city and the gates that had been destroyed by fire. Then on the east side of the city, I went north to the fountain gate and the king's pool. The donkey I was riding could not find any path through the rubble, so I went down into the valley of the Kidron and rode along, looking at the wall. Then I returned the way I had come and went back into the city through the valley gate. None of the local officials knew where I had been or what I had been doing. So far, I had not said anything to any of my fellow Jews, the priests, the leaders, the officials, or anyone else who would be taking part in the work. But now I said to them, "See what trouble we are in because Jerusalem is in ruins and its gates are destroyed. Let's rebuild the city walls and put an end to our disgrace." And I told them how God had been with me and helped me, and what the emperor had said to me. They responded, "Let's start rebuilding," and they got ready to start the work. When Sanballat, Tobiah, and an Arab named Geshem heard what we were planning to do, they laughed at us and said, "What do you think you're doing? Are you going to rebel against the emperor?" I answered, the God of heaven will give us success. We are his servants, and we are going to start building. But you have no right to any property in Jerusalem, and you have no share in its traditions. May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
In chapter 1, when Nehemiah heard the bad news about Jerusalem, how the walls had been broken down, he prayed to the God of heaven. In verse 11, he asked God to cause the king to look on him with favor. Today in chapter 2, we will see how God answered that prayer as Nehemiah carried out his duty as a cupbearer to the king. First heading is, after prayer comes action. It was 4 months after he had received the bad news about Jerusalem. He was serving the king his wine. The king's servants were expected to keep their feelings to themselves and to display a cheerful disposition before him at all times. It was dangerous to show sorrow in the king's presence, and unhappiness could cost you your life. No one is permitted to enter the king's presence, even with mourning clothes. Proverbs 15 and verse 13 says, "A happy heart makes a cheerful face, but heartache crushes the spirit." Nehemiah presumably tried to conceal the pain in his heart for Jerusalem. However, his sad face allowed the king to ask a question. Would you read verse 2, please?
The king asked me, "Why does your face look so sad when you're not ill? This can be nothing but sadness of heart." I was very much afraid.
That was the first question the king asked. Nehemiah was frightened when the king noticed his sad face. He was not ashamed to admit his fear. There is nothing wrong with being afraid. There are great men and women of God in the Bible who did great things for God, but they felt fear. Example, David, Isaiah, Esther, Gideon, and so on. The difference between those who do great things for God and those who do not is that they overcome their fear with prayer. They overcome their fear with prayer. They refuse to let fear paralyze them. When we allow our fear to rule our lives, we make fear more powerful than God. Is there any task God is asking you to do, but fear is holding you back? God is greater than your fear. To recognize your fear is the first step to committing it to God. If there is anyone here in the congregation with the spirit of fear that is holding you in bondage, if you stand up right where you are, I will pray for you. If there's anyone being held in bondage by a spirit of fear, if you stand up, I will pray for you. If God has called you to do a task, he will help you to accomplish it. Nehemiah realized the moment had come for him to speak out what was in his heart. He said, "Let the king live forever." This was a common form of address to kings. 1 Kings 1:13, Daniel 2:4 are examples. It is assumed that the king knew Nehemiah's Jewish ancestry, so he appealed to the king's sympathy. Not mentioning Jerusalem or the temple, but by many mentioning his father's grave and painting a tragic picture of Jerusalem lying in ruin with its gates destroyed by fire. Nehemiah's fear may have slowly begun to evaporate as the king asked him a question, his second question. What is it that you want? Nehemiah prayed. The prayer was probably a silent one, not more than a quick thought. Notice he prayed while he was still talking to the king. I believe he may have said something like this. My God, here is where you can help. The result is in your hand, my God. Nehemiah knew that God is always in charge. He is always present and he hears and answers every prayer, even this quick prayer. Nehemiah had established an intimate relationship with God during the times of extended prayer that we read of in chapter 1, verses 4 to 7. If we want to be confident about our brief prayers, we need to take time to cultivate a strong relationship with God through times of in-depth prayer with God. Nehemiah was not a leader who acted on impulse. In his time of prayer and fasting, he put a lot of thought into the project. He drew up a detailed plan of his action and was able to present a plan of action before the king. Nehemiah does not exclude planning. Prayer does not exclude planning. Let's hear verse 5, please.
And I answered the king, if it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in his sight, let him send me to the city of Judah, where my fathers are buried, so that I can rebuild it.
Nehemiah clearly stated his request. He asked the king for permission to rebuild Jerusalem's wall, and the king granted his request. The king's third question was, how long will you be gone for? The Bible does not record Nehemiah's immediate answer, but from chapter 5 and verse 14, he ended up in Jerusalem for at least 12 years. As soon as he got a positive answer, he began to ask additional help. Would you read verse 7 and 8, please, if you can find it?
I also said to him, if it pleases the king, may I have letters to the governors of Trans-Euphrates so that they will provide me safe conduct until I arrive in Judah.
He asked for more things in verse 8. He asked for letters to give him clear passage. He asked for timber to build a wall and gates. And he also asked for an escort, which he received. That's what I call favor. You come to work to do something for God, and God spoke to him. And in God's thoughts and instructions to Nehemiah had made plans because he knew God would give him an opportunity to talk to the king. And although he was frightened because he did not know whether his life would be spared or not, but Nehemiah had plans of what he would ask the king for. And he made his request to the king. And the king showed him favor. I call that boldness, absolute boldness and absolute trust in God. Sometimes when we have needs, we hesitate to ask the right people for help because we're afraid to approach them. Nehemiah. He went directly to the person who could help him the most. Don't be reluctant to ask those who are most able to help you. They may be more interested and more approachable than you think. God's answer to your prayer may come as a result of asking others. Did you hear that? God's answer to your prayer may come as a result of asking others. The king granted Nehemiah's request. And at the end of verse 8, we read, Nehemiah declared it was because the gracious hand of his God was upon him. He gave all the glory to God. And that's absolutely right. Because all the favor he had got so far was because of God's greatness. The king could have just beheaded him for being miserable in his presence. But God showed him grace and favor. Armed with these letters, the timber, and the military escort, he set off for Jerusalem. Opposition came. His first opposition came. Nehemiah arrived in Judah. He was greeted with opposition. Can we read verse 10, please?
When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official heard about this, they were very much disturbed that someone had come to promote the welfare of the Israelites.
Sanballat and Tobiah were government officials in nearby Samaria. They regarded Nehemiah and his small band of exile as a direct threat to their own authority. They were annoyed that someone had come to promote the welfare of the Israelites. Nehemiah was born in exile, but he was no ordinary exile. He was the king's cupbearer, carrying the king's approval to build and fortify the city. If any man could rebuild Jerusalem, he could. A rebuilt Jerusalem was a threat to the authorities of Samaria, who had been in charge of the land since Judah's exile. They did not want returning exiles taking control of the land and threatening their secure position. Opposition to the rebuilding of Jerusalem had been going on for at least 90 years. God's work is sometimes done in the middle of opposition. Did you hear me? God's work is sometimes done in the middle of opposition. In every generation, there are those who hate God's people and try to block God's purpose. When you attempt to do God's work, some will oppose you. Some will even hope that you fail. If you expect opposition, you can be prepared rather than be surprised. Let's hear what John 3:13 has to say.
Everyone who has this opinion purifies himself, just as he is pure. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness.
Have you got John 3, verse 12? Is that John 3, verse 12? John 3, verse 13.
Do not be surprised, my brothers, if the world hates you.
That's the one. Yeah, go for it.
Do not be surprised, my brothers, if the world hates you.
It reminds us that if we live for God, the world will often hate us. Why? Because we make them shamefully aware of their immoral way of living. But knowing and you are doing what God has asked you to do, you can move ahead in spite of opposition, because God will back you up. Nehemiah spent 3 days resting before undertaking any work. He familiarized himself with the state of Jerusalem and its inhabitants. This inspection confirmed what he had heard from Hananiah in chapter 1. Having sensed opposition, it seems necessary for him to be careful. While the people slept, he was at work, inspecting the wall by night to prevent enemies from being alerted to his plan. Sometimes we have to be wise when we know we have enemies on our back. We need to look for God's wisdom and not act rashly because we know we have God on our side. And that's what Nehemiah did. He took some trusted men with him. Seeing the ruined condition of Jerusalem, the time for tears had passed. Remember, he wept for a very long time. He was heartbroken. But now he'd seen the work that needed to be done firsthand. The time for tears had passed. Now it was time for action. Could you read verse 17, please?
If anyone has material possessions and sees his brothers in need...
Hey! We're looking for chapter 2 and verse 17. Nehemiah chapter 2 verse 17. So sorry, brother. Nehemiah chapter 2 and verse 17. God is so good. It's all good. It's all good.
Then I said to them, you see the trouble we're in. Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let's rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we'll no longer be in disgrace.
Did you notice what Nehemiah said? Come, let us rebuild. Let us, not you rebuild, let us rebuild. He committed himself to the people and the work. He did not expect them to do anything he himself was not willing to do. We will see later in the book how he got stuck in with the people rebuilding the wall. After he had his inspection, he realized how bad the work was. He needed a team to work with him. He could not do it on his own. And he took his proposal to the people. Spiritual renewal often begins with one person's vision. Spiritual renewal often begins with one person's vision. We frequently underestimate people and don't challenge them with our dreams for God's work in the world. When God plants an idea in your mind to accomplish something for him, share it with others and trust the Holy Spirit to impress them with similar thoughts. Did you hear that? When God plants an idea in your mind to accomplish something for him, share it with others and trust the Holy Spirit to impress them with similar thoughts. And God will always do that. We saw it in Nehemiah's case. I've seen it with people in the church here. Don't see yourself as the only one for whom God is working. Often, God uses one person to express the vision and others to turn it into reality. You always need a team to make things happen. When you encourage and inspire others, you put teamwork into action to accomplish God's goal. Amen? Like all good leaders, Nehemiah inspired confidence, shared his vision with enthusiasm. His call and testimony were so effective that the people responded positively. Let us start rebuilding. And so the work began. Let's read Nehemiah 2, verse 19. Please.
But when Sanballat the Aaronite, Tobiah the Ammonite official, and Geshem the Arab heard about it, they mocked and ridiculed us. What is this you are doing? They asked. Are you rebelling against the king?
Sometimes opposition is a sign that we are doing something wrong. But in this case, opposition was a sign that Nehemiah was doing something right. Sanballat and Tobiah, from verse 10, and now they were joined by Goshen, the Arab, who opposed Nehemiah's work. While good people can encourage each other to do good work, evil people will also poison others to oppose a good work. Did you hear me? While good people will encourage each other to do good work, evil people will also poison others to oppose a good work. We see that every day. We see that in our country, we see it in the world, we hear it on the news. Verse 19 shows us that hatred could no longer be confined to the heart, but expressed itself through mockery, ridicule, and lies. You know, sometimes when you're trying to do something good for God, people don't like it. If they can see that, they can't discourage you. They will mock you, they will ridicule you, and they will tell lies about you. But you need to keep going. Like Nehemiah, those serving God may encounter opposition despite their prayers. Did you hear that? Despite your prayers, despite your planning, you will have opposition sometimes. Doesn't mean you haven't prayed. It doesn't mean you have no faith. It doesn't mean that the work you're doing is not good. You will still have opposition. But you need to keep going. Don't let those who are doing nothing for God stop you doing something for God. Because you know what it's like. You will want to do something. Others don't want to do it, but they will stop you doing it. Instead of saying, well, go ahead, let you do it, see how far you get, they will want to stop you. They don't want to get involved, but they want to stop you. They can see the work needs to be done. They don't want to do it, but they will stop you doing it. But you must never let people who will not lift a finger for God stop you doing something for God. God is looking to you to do something for him. That's why he's called us. God has not called us just to be saved to go to heaven. God has called us to build his kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. God has called us to show mercy. God has called us to show compassion. God has called us to intercede. God has called us to give help. God has called us to put a loving arm around somebody. God has called us to give a gift to somebody who's in need. God has called us to build our kingdom so his presence can come in and change wherever we are. God is an amazing God, but he needs you and I to bring his kingdom in. That's why we're saved. We are soldiers in the army of the Most High God. Did you hear me? Soldiers are on duty, aren't they? Soldiers are not sitting on the beach soaking up sun. No. Soldiers in the army are active doing the work of protecting the kingdom. But we're active doing the work of ushering God's kingdom in so people can know that there is a God. He's real, he's powerful, he loves them, and he wants to meet them right where they are. And he wants to change their lives. Just the same way he's changed our lives. We are soldiers in the army. God will do great things with a committed few, regardless of mockery, regardless of criticism, regardless of ridicule, and regardless of lies. Did you hear me? God will do great things with a committed few. How many disciples changed the world? How many disciples changed the world? Was it 12? Oh, you're asleep. I'll wake you up. Don't worry. I'm here to wake you up this morning. 12 disciples changed the world. That's why we're here. Because 12 disciples were faithful to the great commission that God gave them. Go into all the world and make disciples. They were committed. It wasn't easy. Read Acts of the Apostles. Some of them were beheaded. Some of them were in prison. Some of them had to run for their lives. But the kingdom of God would still come. So in spite of mockery, in spite of criticism, in spite of ridicule, and in spite of lies, God's kingdom must come. Because God is committed to bringing his kingdom in. God is greater than all these. God is greater than all these. Who are you? Are you one of those who will help to build the kingdom of God? Or are you one of those who will criticize and discourage? Who are you? Who are you? One of the accusations directed against the Jews is that they were planning to rebel against the king. They didn't realize Nehemiah had already thought about that. Nehemiah did not tell them he had permission from the king to rebuild. That's why it's so important to pray and sometimes even fast to hear what God is saying. And Nehemiah knew that there would be opposition. So he wanted permission right from the word go. They won't stop me crossing the border. They might stop me because I know the devil is busy. The devil is always trying to hinder God's word. So can I have a letter so I can get free passage, please? Yeah, that's good. Well, can I get another letter so when I get there, they won't oppose me doing your work? And by the way, can I have timber as well? Because their people might be poor and they might not want having timber. Can I have timber? Oh, yes. Oh, and you know how evil the devil is? Can I have an escort? God is amazing. God is amazing. God will see that his work is accomplished despite Satan and his evil workers. God is committed. God is stronger than Satan. And God is stronger than opposition. God is stronger than criticism. And God is stronger than life. That's why you need to say amen.
Amen.
Although the accusation is not true, it had the potential to damage the morale of the people. Nehemiah, the man of God, refused to become involved in any argument with his opposition. Did you hear that? He refused to get involved with their arguments. He already knew he had permission to get on with the work. Sometimes you need to let your opponents and your accusers go. And you just keep your head down, keep going. Keep going because you know God is on your side. Let them chat, let them walk, let them tell lies, but keep going. You're on a mission in the name of Jesus. While the enemies expressed the hatred that was in their heart, Nehemiah said he had God's approval and that was enough. Read verse 20, please. Nehemiah 2.
I answered them by saying, the God of heaven will give us success. We, his servants, will start rebuilding, but as for you, you have no share in Jerusalem or any claim or historic right to it.
Nehemiah humbly declared that he was only a servant. The outcome would be God's doing and not man's accomplishment. As we continue to go through the book of Nehemiah, we will see that despite human opposition, the work will succeed because it is God's work and it was God who called Nehemiah. Like Nehemiah, leaders must develop the need and the vision for the future. And they must also inspire their workers to stand firm and work faithfully in the midst of opposition. We need godly men and women and young people in the church, in schools, in colleges, universities, and in every place of employment to be like Nehemiah, who fear no one but God only. When you fear no one but God only, you will keep on going. I was at a minister's meeting on, I think it was Wednesday, and we were talking about the kingdom of God. And we heard that Nicky Gamble used to do, I think he still does, a program, what's it called? Alpha, that's the one, called Alpha. But now, he took out the section about the devil, evil, out of the section, and he took out the section about homosexual out of the course. Do you see how the devil comes in and intimidates us, and then we backtrack? That course has been going on for years, and thousands of people have been saved. But because the world is out there saying, I dare you to do that. I dare you to say that. We backtrack. And we forget, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. Let God be true and everyone a liar. I dare us to say that when we go out today. I dare us to stand up for God in spite of what the world is saying. Lock me up if you must. Oh, hallelujah. Lock me up for Jesus. Don't lock me up for any crime, but lock me up for a crime where Jesus is implicated. Please lock me up. I would love to be suffering for Jesus. What he did on the cross for me was nothing compared to what I would be doing in a jailhouse is nothing compared to what he did for me on the cross. We need to be strong. We need to be warriors. We need to be soldiers of the cross. Stop backtracking and stop making excuses because we're Christians. We're Christians because we carry the name of Jesus, and God is true and God is real, and his word stands and it will stand through every generation. It cannot be put out. He said, my word will always endure forever. Laws will come, laws will go, but the word of God will endure forever. As we continue to see the change in our nation for the worse, we don't get discouraged. We don't get overwhelmed. Sometimes you listen to the news and you don't know where to start for prayer. Jesus help us is enough. Jesus help in that situation. Jesus move into that situation. Jesus take your place in that situation. Jesus do what you need to do in that situation. That's enough. We don't need long prayers. Don't get overwhelmed. Let Jesus do what he needs to do. Just call on his name and he will do what he needs to do. There's no need for us to be overwhelmed. He is the burden bearer and he will carry it for us. But by God's grace, we can declare, let us rebuild together. Let us go forward with faith and prayer to do great things for God. Amen. I believe it was William Carey who said, expect great things from our God. Attempt great things for our God. Because we have a great God. Amen. Church, the days are evil, but God is great. Time is hard, but God is faithful. Our hearts are broken, but we have hope in Jesus. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Look to our God. He has power that we know nothing about. He will give us favor at every turn, like he gave me mine. That guy was born, wasn't he? Let me go and rebuild the world.
Okay.
Is there anything else? Oh yes, by the way, God gave him favor. Go out into the world and expect favor from God. Because you are a child of God and God will give you favor. That's what he said. He said, my favor will surround you like a shield. Let his favour surround you like a shield as you go out this week. Do not backtrack. We're not for retreating. Let the devil retreat. We don't retreat. We're on the winning side. The victory has already been won in Jesus' name. We're on the winning side. We will never lose with Jesus. It may appear that we're losing, but we're not. Did you hear me, church? Let us arise and build. Let us arise and build in the name of Jesus. Let us work to see his kingdom come and his will be done on earth as it is. Amen. Father, we thank you so much that you are a mighty God and you are on the move in spite of what the newspapers say, in spite of what the television say. You are building your church and the gates of hell will never prevail against it. You are building a people of power and you're building a people of praise. You are coming for a victorious church. And we read that there will be a number that no one can number. Just the same way you said to Elijah, there are 7,000 that has not bowed the knees to Baal. We know, God, that you're in the business of saving. And you will save until you return. May your church be encouraged as we walk with you. May our church be brave and strong as we believe in the authority of the Word of God and as we believe in the supernatural power of a miracle working God. Let faith arise in us today and let our enemies be scattered in the name of Jesus. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Father. Bless your word to your people. Establish your word in our hearts and minds today. For your glory and honor, we pray. Amen. Amen. Let us stand.